let me welcome our eminent speaker, Professor Saurabh Dube, chair of today's lecture, and our partners, Pilani, Goa campus, represented by Professor Meenakshi Raman, head Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at the Goa campus, and Professor Pratima Kamath, head Department of History at Goa University. Please welcome them with a round of applause. Professor Dube is going to deliver a lecture which is part of our series called ICG Lecture Series by Eminent Persons, and it's the 13th lecture in this series. This series was started in August 2012 with a lecture by Mr. Maruf Raza, followed by eminent ambassadors including Ambassador G. Parthasarthi, Ambassador B. S. Prakash, Ambassador Rakesh Sood, Commander C. Uday Bhaskar, Dr. Shridhar Datta, Ambassador Rajiv Sikri, Professor Mahendra Lama, Professor Srikant Kondapalli, Dr. Manav Bose, and recently last year we had Ambassador Rajendra Abhayankar. As we start, may I request the President of International Centre Goa, Mr. Yatin Kapurkar, to formally welcome our eminent speakers and the guests.
Professor Kumkum Roy, Professor Saurabh Dube, Professor Pratima Kamath, Professor Meenakshi Raman, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this lecture on Modernisms in India by Professor Saurabh Dube, Professor of History from El Palacio de Mexico. As President of ICG, I have delivered several welcome addresses in this very hall. But today is something unique and very special. It is for the first time that ICG is holding a lecture jointly with BITS Pilani Goa campus. Though we have had a program with Goa University at ICG, it is for the first time that ICG is holding a lecture jointly with the Department of History of Goa University. It has been my wish for a long time that ICG, BITS Pilani Goa campus, and Goa University join hands and hold a program together. Today, this wish has come true. This joining of minds from three different institutes is of course an intellectual confluence, but it is also a sharing of intellectual resources, an idea which makes a lot of sense in a world which is seeing the rise of sharing economy, or what they say, collaboration. BITS Pilani Goa campus has invited Professor Saurabh Dube from Mexico to the Goa campus, but I have today joined hands with ICG in arranging for his lecture for students of Goa University. Professor Kumkum Roy is a visiting research professor at Goa University, and she is here at ICG to chair Professor Dube's lecture, which has been arranged by BITS Pilani. This is a very good collaborative development and makes me very happy. This is only the beginning, and I'm sure we will continue to work together and jointly whenever opportunities arise. We are very privileged to have not just one, but two scholars, Professor Dube and Professor Roy. Professor Dube is a sociologist and anthropologist, and Professor Roy is a leading expert in the social sciences and history. I'm sure we'll all enjoy listening to Professor Dube and Professor Kumkum Roy as the chair of the lecture. With these few words of mine, I once again welcome you all to the lecture and hope you enjoy yourself. Thank you.
Before we hand over the proceedings of today's lecture to the chair, may I invite Professor Meenakshi Raman, Head Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, BITS Pilani, to kindly introduce a speaker for this morning.
Distinguished speaker, guests on the dais, students and other distinguished guests at the audience. A very good morning to all of you, and it is indeed a great privilege for me to have got an opportunity to introduce Professor Dube at this August gathering. I would like to thank the ICG, Mr. Kapurkar and Mr. Arjun, for having invited us here. And today is the registration day for us. The students have come back from the holidays and then registration is going on. Still, we thought that we should attend this lecture. And this is the first opportunity we have got to have organized something with ICT Goa. And we would like to have more collaborations, such collaborations in future as well. Let me introduce Professor Dube. Dr. Saurabh Dube is a professor of history at the Center for Asian and African Studies, College of Mexico. Professor Dube holds a PhD in history from the University of Cambridge and an MPhil in history from the University of Delhi. A fellow of the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla, he has held visiting positions at several prestigious universities in the US, Europe and elsewhere, including Cornell University, Johns Hopkins University and the University of Warwick. He has lectured widely at universities and research centers across the world. An author and editor of more than 20 books in English and Spanish, Professor Dube first published Untouchable Past, Religion, Identity and Power Among a Central Indian Community, 1780 to 1950, in the year 1998. Most recently, Subjects of Modernity, Time, Space, Disciplines, Margins, that is forthcoming with the Manchester University Press. There are many more things. I am just giving a very brief CV of Professor Dube introduction. But if you want, you can visit his website and you can get more information, because it is beyond, you know, if I start introducing his, you know, all his achievements, etc., it may take an hour or so. It is very impressive resume he has. In addition, of course, he has published scores of journal articles and book chapters. Much of Professor Dube's research and writing is around the themes of colonialism, religion, culture, caste and modernity, combining the disciplines and approaches of history, anthropology and sociology. With such an impressive list of accomplishments, it's not surprising that he holds the position of a distinguished research professor and the highest rank of national researcher level 3 in the National System of Researchers, Mexico. I welcome Professor Dube and the president and the chairperson for this session, and also all of you to this lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. We from International Center also look forward to a very interesting collaboration between ICG and Mexico Goa University. May I now request Professor Pratima Kamath, Head Department of History at Goa University, to kindly introduce the chair of today's session, Professor Kumkum Roy, and hand over the proceedings to her.
Professor Dube, Professor Roy, Professor Ramwan, ladies and gentlemen, and my dear students, it gives me great pleasure to present to you the chairperson of this morning's function, Professor Kumkum Roy. She is the visiting research professor under Goa University's D.B. Kosambi Chair in Interdisciplinary Studies, and she is currently engaging lectures related to history and historiography and feminism at Goa University. These lectures will run through for this entire week from the 11th to the 15th of January. Professor Roy is a professor at the Center for Historical Studies of JNU, which has been her alma mater, from where she has earned both her master's as well as doctoral degrees in the subject of history. Prior to joining JNU in the year 1999, Professor Roy has taught at Delhi University and its affiliated colleges. The areas of her research interest include early Indian history and gender studies. Her doctoral research was on the emergence of monarchy in North India, mid-first millennium BCE. This was based on a study of later and post-Vedic textual sources, which were analyzed to explore the complex connections between the emergence of political institutions and domestic relations. Professor Roy has also been keenly interested in teaching of history in schools, developing curriculum and textbooks in collaboration with the Delhi SCERT and the NCERT. One of her main areas of research interest is in engendering studies of early Indian social history, in particular, and gender or women's studies in general. Professor Roy's current research interests include exploring questions of intertextuality in early and early medieval Sanskrit texts, with a special focus on representations of gender, marginalized peoples, and liminal spaces. Professor Roy has, to her credit, a large number of articles which she has contributed to national and international journals. She has also authored a number of books which include The Emergence of Monarchy in North India, 8th to 4th centuries BC, as reflected in the Brahminical tradition, which was published by Oxford University Press in 1994, A Historical Dictionary of Ancient India, which was brought out by the Scarecrow Press in 2010, The Power of Gender and the Gender of Power, Explorations in Early Indian History, is another of her books, brought out by the OUP in 2010. In addition to these books, she also has edited a number of works, which include Women in Early Indian Societies, published by Manohar in 1999, Insights and Interventions, Essays in Honor of Uma Chakravarti, brought out by Primus Publications 2011, Looking Within, Looking Without, Exploring Households in the Subcontinent Through Time, Essays in Honor of Nandita Prasad Sahai, brought out by Primus in 2014. For her seminal contribution to academics, Professor Roy has received several fellowships and awards. I will mention just a few of them. She was awarded the Commonwealth Academic Staff Fellowship for postdoctoral research tenable at the School of Oriental and African Studies, London, 1994-95. She was also awarded fellowship tenable at the Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla, in the year 1998. She has served as a sectional president of the Indian History Congress in 2008 and was the recipient of the Hiralal Gupta Award for Women's Historians in 2011. Currently, she is senior fellow at the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, New Delhi. And as I've already mentioned to you, she is with us right now at Goa University as a visiting research professor under Goa University's D.D. Kosambi Chair in Interdisciplinary Studies, conducting lectures for this entire week. Ladies and gentlemen, I give to you Professor Kumkum Roy.
Friends, thank you very much for these long and very detailed introductions. I will not add more to those at the moment. I just want to mention a couple of things. I first met Saurabh Dube more than 20 years ago, and that's when I first had an opportunity to hear him. Over these two decades, I've followed his work. We haven't met in all these years. But I think there are two things about his work which make them especially significant. One is that he has opened up fresh areas of study in several of his works and has posed challenges to us as historians. He has practiced interdisciplinarity in a way in which I think many of us claim to do but actually don't. So that makes his work particularly interesting. And the way in which he combines insights drawn from the archives with field work makes his work is especially challenging for us as historians. So with that, I'd like to hand over to you.
Thank you for those generous introductions. It is a pleasure and privilege to be at the International Centre of Goa. I thank Sri Bhagwatkar, Dr. Kamath, Professor Raman, Dr. Sinha, and Sri Halalinder for agreeing to chair for making this possible, and Sir Roy for agreeing to chair this session. I'm also, of course, grateful to all of you for being here. My presentation is titled Modernisms in India. It draws upon the epilogue to a book in front, a book that works through critical understandings of time, space, and their enmeshments. The book is called Subjects of Modernity and is forthcoming later this year from Manchester University Press. My presentation today attends to salient subjects of a modernist provenance on the Indian subcontinent. By modernism, I'm referring to aesthetic and artistic practices that have extended from the mid and late 19th century into our own present. Now, in South Asia, a certain haziness regarding modernism and modernity derives not only from the manner in which they can be confused, elided with each other, but the fact that they are both modernism and modernity, they are both frequently filtered through the optics of modernization. At stake is the acute, albeit altering, importance of being modern as a person, a nation, and a people. This is true not only of quotidian common sense, but of scholarly sentiments. Here, modernization implicitly involves pervasive projections of material, organizational, and technological, as well as economic, political, and cultural transformations. These changes are principally envisioned, understood in the looking glass of Western development. Such a West or Europe is at once entirely imaginary and terribly tangible. In this scenario, tacitly at least, different, often hierarchically ordered peoples are seen as succeeding or failing to evolve from their traditional circumstance to arrive at a modernized order. Indeed, motives of modernization carrying wide implication readily draw together mappings of modernism, modernity, and being modern such that each shores up the other. Why should this be the case? To begin with, a crucial characteristic of dominant descriptions of modernity has hinged on their positing of the phenomena as marked by a break with the past, a rupture with tradition, a surpassing of the medieval. Here, through ruses of ideological historical progress, stages of civilization, and social evolutionist schemas, through such ruses, by the second half of the 19th century, across much of the world, an exclusive West was increasingly presented as the mirror for the imagining of universal history. Here was worldly knowledge that was born alike by empire and nation. This knowledge was oriented not merely toward ordering, towards understanding. But to simultaneously remaking the world. In this way, these neat proposals and their formative presumptions variously entered the lives of South Asian subjects. On the Indian subcontinent, across the 20th century, such principles and presuppositions were first disseminated as ways of approaching social worlds. Soon, they were instituted as tissues of experience and structures of sentiment within everyday arenas, at the very least among middle-class subjects. In this scenario, the blueprints of modernization actually distilled the meanings of the modern, articulating an imaginary but aggrandizing West or Europe as modernity for all those awaiting its second coming in prior places, anachronistic spaces lagging in time. In artistic, intellectual, and aesthetic arenas, modernisms in South Asia have variously, often critically, engaged with these projections and presuppositions. But they have also been unable to easily escape their long shadow. This is also true of scholarship on modernism in India, which appears intimately tied to modernist practices on the subcontinent. Thus, in the work of, say, Geeta Kapoor, Partha Mitra, or Supriya Chaudhary, modernization and modernity are uneasily folded into understandings of modernism. Needless to say, of course, that these works have also all been crucial to my understanding of modernisms in India. So critical engagement is not about a dismissal, it's our further understanding. The point now is that modernist tendencies on the subcontinent have formed part of diverse expressions across the world of modernism as contentious and contradictory movements, styles, and representations. These tendencies go back to the mid-19th century and extend into our own times. Here, modernism has been a principally qualitative rather than a merely chronological category. At the same time, it is also the case that on the subcontinent, as elsewhere, the internal endeavors within modernisms to surpass the past, articulate the present, and envision the future have been intrinsically heterogeneous ones. On the one hand, modernist initiatives in India have severally accessed and exceeded colonial representations and pre-colonial narratives, nationalist thought and nativist tradition, primitivism and futurity, abstract reason and religious truth, and governmental authority and popular politics. There are parallels here with modernist endeavors elsewhere. On the other hand, South Asian initiatives equally sieve such concerns through distinct expressions of modernism. Thus, they at once questioned the colonial connection with a generally bourgeois modern, articulated the national dynamic with an often avant-garde modern, and explored the critical contours of a contending primitivist modern. In this way, they rethought the content of tradition and debated the nature of modernity. Imbued with specific spatial densities and tousled, mixed up temporal energies, this has provided South Asian modernisms with their own twist, discrete textures. A key characteristic of modernism at large has been to emphasize the difference of the contemporary present from past epochs. Within South Asian modernisms, this claim of a surpassing of the past turned on space and time. The claim was variously influenced by the gravity of anti-colonial and nationalist imaginaries, the weight of memory and history, the pull of the mythic and the primitive, and the burden of a violent independence and post-colonial politics. This is to say, these endeavors inhabiting, quote, multiple constellations throughout the 20th century appear critically shot through by a dialectical process of invoking, resisting, or negotiating questions of tradition, identity, and experience, unquote, as Sanjukta Sundarasan puts it. It followed, too, that breaks with prior artistic moments within subcontinental aesthetic landscapes, alongside engagements with wider modernist imaginaries, instill these tendencies with rather particular energies. All of this has meant that the paradoxical, even opposed trends that have characterized modernisms at large, acquired in South Asia a discrete cadence, unfamiliar attributes. In what follows, I shall elaborate these first formulations by focusing on distinct modernist moments in South Asia. Implicitly and explicitly, I shall especially explore issues of time and space. But what is it that I mean by time and space? Consider now that space and time are often understood as being not only amorphous, but also abstract, or apprehended in a priori ways. Let us register too that these concepts, entities, time and space, have each found varied salient expressions in the disciplines studying physical worlds. This recognized, my concern is with the social dimensions of these categories and processes. Intimately enmeshed, the one with the other, social space and social time are far from being merely passive contexts, readily given backdrops, and already received conduits for human action. Rather, time and space, elaborated together by social subjects, are at once critical constituents and active outcomes, formative attributes and key consequences of meaning and power, alterity and authority, and practice and process that define our worlds and their divisions. In this presentation, The temporal spatial imperatives under discussion are culled from within modernist practices themselves. These aesthetic procedures sieved and reworked distinct influences through a self-directed aesthetic. Here, my bid is to follow chronology. My effort is to follow chronology in order to rethink chronology and to use taxonomy in order to undo taxonomy. In these ways, I hope to foreground the multiple yet overlaying temporal articulations and spatial stimulations of modernisms in South Asia. By the beginning of the 20th century, British rule was 150 years old on the Indian subcontinent. This period had seen shifting, layered entanglements and conflicts between the colonizer and the colonized. The suppression of dynamic yet contentious processes turning on indigenous authority and political economy, the containment of fluid borders between field and forest, and the subordination of the Indian economy to North Atlantic cycles of trade, profit-making, and consumption. On the one hand, the systematic destruction of forests, the conversion of commons into property, and the emphasis on increasing land revenue had led to the lineaments of an agrarian order consisting of settled agriculture and specialist commodity production. This was marked by relatively clear groupings of caste and community, which had earlier been more fluid, even amorphous, identifications. These processes had lasting legacies for the nationalist and imperial imaginaries, including modernist ones. Village, agriculture, and caste arrangements that had acquired their distinct terms and textures principally across the 19th century were now rendered as ageless, timeless, millennia-old innate attributes of a spatially singular Indian civilization. On the other hand, this extended epoch had witnessed uneven yet acute articulations of colonial urbanism. At stake were debates on the content of tradition and formations of gender on the subcontinent, religious negotiations of evangelical encounters, nationalist contestations of colonial claims, and varied experiments with European traditions in the letters, arts, and politics. Against the backdrop of these broad-based twin movements for formations of aesthetics in South Asia, I recount a vignette from the early 20th century. I quote, on 7th May 1921, the Indian poet Rabindranath Tagore celebrated his 60th birthday in Weimar and in Germany and used the opportunity to visit the Bauhaus. Soon, at Tagore's suggestion, a selection of Bauhaus works was shipped to Calcutta to be exhibited in December 1922 at the 14th annual exhibition of the Society of Oriental Art. Among the exhibits, which mysteriously never returned to Europe, among the exhibits were two watercolors by Kandinsky and nine by Paul Klee, and a larger number of other pieces by many different artists. The exhibition was well received, but what was perhaps even more important about it was that a number of Cubist paintings by Rabindranath's nephew, Gaganendranath Tagore, and four primitivist works by his niece, Sunayani Devi, were also shown on this occasion, unquote. I'm citing here Supriya Chaudhary, who draws upon Parthamitra. At least three points stand out. First, at stake in the exhibition was a break with the formidable influence of prior nationalist art, especially the Orientalism of the Bengal school. The Bengal school had configured a counter-colonial, pan-Asian style of narrative painting as part of Swadeshi nationalism of 1905 to 1911. It had also opposed the academic naturalism of narrative art. This is the Bengal school. But now, a newer disposition came to the fore. Thus, one form of counter-colonial sensibility appealing to bourgeois nationalists was replaced by a modernist anti-imperial imaginary. This new modernist anti-imperial imaginary would soon draw on the energies of the subcontinental popular, announcing shifts that were aesthetic and political, temporal and spatial. Second, the appearance of modernism in art in India cannot be reduced to the ready influence of the Bauhaus or of Europe West at large. Rather, it is the experiments of Gaganendranath, and in a different way, those of his cousin Sunaini, that appear as an inaugural moment. It is the experience of Gaganendranath that appear as an inaugural moment of the modernist idiom in Indian art. None of this involved a mere imitation of European modernism. Actually, in Gaganendranath's work, quote, a dynamic, fluid, mysterious play of light and shape and color, unquote, replaced the relatively static geometry of analytical cubism. This revealed also an imagination steeped in literature and myth, setting to work in itself construing a time-space that was prior, yet present, as idea and practice. Unsurprisingly, too, such work was discussed as the quest for artistic autonomy in the modernist journals of the day. Now, I'm very sorry, you know, I should have had images for all this, which would have just sort of gone through, but all this was to have been done in Mexico, and one of my research assistants, when he heard about the proposal of gathering all the stuff, just bolted, he ran. And the other one says that he's just been operated on, so he's immobile. So I don't know, I don't think they're lying, but this one is lying, but I don't have the images. I do have other images, but, you know, relate to, you know, what I'd be talking of towards the end. Third, while Gaganendranath's work remains something of an exception in terms of its broader impact, the folk imaginary underlying the art of his sister Sunaini had wide implications. It not only affected the primitivist motives of the artist Jamini Roy, a point usually acknowledged, the imaginary arguably also formed an integral part of larger expressions of primitivism and ruralism in modernist art in India. These expressions bore acutely spatial-temporal dimensions while being shaped by distinct configurations of anti-colonial nationalism on the subcontinent. Until the end of the 1910s, Indian nationalism had remained a principally middle-class and elite phenomenon, despite some attempts during the Swadeshi period to draw in popular participation in nationalist agitation. All this was to change from the beginnings of the 1920s as M.K. Gandhi, not yet the Mahatma, all this was to change from the beginnings of the 1920s as M.K. Gandhi took decisive steps to transform Indian nationalism. He turned the Indian National Congress into a firm grouping with an organizational structure and regular membership, rather than a forum that met at the end of each year. Gandhi's political strategy was to draw in the participation of the Indian masses, especially the peasants, yet to do so in a rigorously controlled manner, such that the subalterns obeyed and followed the Congress leadership. At the same time, the nationalist endeavor to discipline and mobilize, as it were, was equally accompanied by Gandhian ideology and practice that struck an acutely anti-industrial, anti-urban note. Here what we found an imaginatively counter-modern cadence. So this is the point I'm making. Here what we found an imaginatively counter-modern cadence, turning on a critique of Western civilization, a valorization of the village and tradition, and an innately moral politics. These were all arguably grounded in the reinvigoration of an unsullied space-time. The subordinate groups, in turn, came to articulate their own supplementary anti-colonial politics and perceptions of nationalism and nation. Founded in everyday practices, these perceptions and politics exceeded the official Congress understanding. Now, all of this informed the aesthetic, spatial-temporal expressions of folk and primitivist imaginaries in modernist Indian art. There were different trajectories here. Nandalal Bose, who presided over the art school at Tagore's Shantiniketan, conjoined the folk styles, bold brush strokes, and outdoor murals in an eclectic practice. This served to engender an aesthetic discourse rooted in a principally timeless community, signifying a timeless community, signifying the space of the nation. Bose was intimately associated with Mahatma Gandhi, now Mahatma, especially producing wall panels for the Haripura session of the Indian National Congress in 1938. Arguably, the association of nationalism, community, and the insistence on a formal artistic clarity acquired distinct dimensions among Bose's students. Now, the painter A.G. Subramanian honed an expressive, imaginative, figurative style. Distinctively, the sculptor Ramkinkar Bej, a remarkable talent from a humble background and with scant formal education, Ramkinkar Bej represented the lives of the Adivasi Santals, creating monumental outdoor sculptures of these subjects in cement, rubble, and concrete. He showcased thereby what we might call a subaltern modernism. Here was a modernism that imbued allegedly anachronistic subjects with formidable aesthetic and existential coevalness, nowness, a temporal and spatial energy that was at once prior, acutely present, and entirely future. Indeed, taken together, on offer was a questioning of the colonial connection with a bourgeois modern, articulations of the national dynamic with an avant-garde modern, and explorations of the critical contours of a contending primitivist modern. At the same time, the density and gravity of artistic interchanges often went beyond the formal influence of anti-colonial nationalisms in articulations of modernist, folk, and primitivist imaginaries in South Asia. Here, Chamini Roy's primitivism arrived at a striking modernist brevity through a simplification of form and an elimination of details. Drawing on folk forms while rooting his work in local artisanal practice, Roy created an art at odds with colonial urban culture, precisely through its intrinsic valorization of the communitarian in actual aesthetic practice. In a related manner, Rabindranath Tagore's own modernist internationalism was not only founded on critical intimations of the illegitimacy of nationalism. It is also the case that Tagore's forceful, mask-like, virtually totemic images were an acute expression of, quote, the dark landscape of the psyche, unquote, as Partho Mitra puts it. Finally, away from Bengal, painting in North India, Amrita Shergill's primitivist art was at once formatively modernist and startlingly cosmopolitan, drawing comparisons with her Mexican contemporary Frida Kahlo. Shergill's art went far beyond merely indigenous influences. It intimated instead a politics of art that refuses to be reduced to prescribed ideology. In each instance, at stake are formative configurations of space and time as parts of the reworking of tradition and of the rethinking of modernity within Indian modernist artistic practices, issues which yet await fuller understanding. From the 1920s onwards, anti-colonial nationalism, drawing in popular participation, appeared accompanied by connected yet contending tendencies, socialism and communism. Indeed, nationalism, socialism, and communism could now form compelling friendships and now forge intimate enmities. Such intellectual political impulses had a profound impact on the arts, from painting to literature to theater to cinema in the 1940s. The twisted times of famine and suffering, an anti-fascist war and subaltern struggles, the end of empire and intimations of independence saw the formations of progressive organizations such as the Indian People's Theatre Association and various artist groups. This wider left cultural movement sought to create in art a distinct, popular, national in form, socialist in content. It brought together artists, writers, and performers in a common platform to fashion the idiom of progressive art. You're thinking at once of Sadatha Sanmanto and of Balraj Sahni. Even as these initiatives were being expressed, the subcontinent gained independence from British imperial rule. The event was itself accompanied by the partition of subcontinental territories and subjects, each innately socio-spatial, into separate nations. The hopes and desires of the new citizens, the time spaces of their habitation and imagination, were fragmented, even split, by the violence that marked the partition. While estimates vary, and I was stunned by this, I mean, you may know the figures, but I was absolutely stunned when I was looking this. While estimates vary, between 200,000 and 1.5 million Muslims, Hindus, and Sikhs were killed in the violence, including reciprocal genocide. Around 75,000 women were raped and or abducted in the drawing and redrawing of the boundaries of these communities. And a little less than 15 million people were displaced, losing home and belonging across new borders, borders that were as concrete as they were imaginary. Some of the split nature of these processes, which fabricated and jumbled terrible temporalities and shadowy spaces, was captured by Nehru in his famous Tryst with Destiny speech, delivered at the stroke of the midnight hour. Yet much of this failed to convince modernist artists and authors. To be sure, the communist slogan, Ye Azadi Jhooti Hai, this freedom is a lie, did not prove too persuasive. But the recognition of a truncated freedom, a compromised independence, and partition's violence not only called into question the space-time of the new nations, they actually haunted the modernist imagination at large. Nor were these specters, these phantasms, these ghosts, nor were these specters laid to rest as India embarked on a vigorous program of nation building based on a governmentally planned economy, state presence in heavy industry, and the building of large dams and other monumental public works. Indeed, what came to the fore was a nation and society lacking in soul and spirit. Against this were variously pitted issues of artistic autonomy, aesthetic independence, individual alienation, and social commitment in the quest for a new modern. This modern and modernism was to be avant-garde in expression, yet Indian in essence. Imagination and practice in which uncommon spatial temporal matrices of epic, legend, and myth often played a critical role. Here, I provide a series of juxtapositions from different art forms. In the wake of independence and partition, modernisms in South Asia saw an acute overlay of artistic technique and the force of the past. An incessant interchange between the density of aesthetic traditions, their autonomy, and the urgency of the present. An acute interplay between claims and tradition and the control of space-time. This past and present, technique and aesthetic, and time and space had to be made modern for the people, for the nation in the making, with its flaws and fractures. Some of this is clarified by the terms of theater in mid-20th century. The activities of the Indian People's Theater Association, IPTA, turned on progressive performances, realist drama, and social critique. These were aimed towards cultural awakening among the people of the subcontinent. At the same time, rather than being consumed by a limited aesthetic politics of agitation and propaganda, agitprop, here were to be found many artistic innovations. Such innovations drew upon the resources of realism in order to reveal rather other glimmers of modernist theatre. Thus, in South Asia, the social impact drama of the 1940s was followed by cutting-edge developments. These developments critically, imaginatively articulated epic and the avant-garde, myth and the contemporary, legend and the present, the temporal and the spatial, in expressions of modernism, developments that yet remain insufficiently conceptualized. Unsurprisingly, in progressive endeavors in the plastic arts, questions of a practice that was adequate to an emergent era, an invite nationalism and a modern art came to be of critical import. In such a scenario, what was the precise place of a new nation, India, its space-time within a novel aesthetic? Did the nation implicitly uphold the aesthetic or the aesthetical, providing also the context and support for the emergences? Or did the nation as form and substance hinder aesthetic autonomy? It followed that these artistic efforts could follow different directions, but none could escape the demands of avant-garde autonomy, ever on the edge of social space and transient time. Thus, the most influential of these artists' organizations, the Progressive Artists Group of Bombay, which was founded at the end of 1947 as a response to the partition, spoke not only of a radical break from the past, but of an autonomy of the work of art itself. And I quote from their dialogue, quote, absolute freedom for content and technique, almost anarchic. At the same time, the articulations of such autonomy were deeply entangled with the density of myth and memory, closely connected with the intimations of palpable past and receding presents. Myth and memory, past and present, that were sown into the landscape and adrift in the air. So there's a palpable quality about them. We shouldn't just think of them as airy-fairy things. Indeed, these temporal spatial resources could be a means of unraveling the pain of the partition, the puzzle of the nation, the ambiguity of identity, and the force of exile. Two salient examples should suffice. They both emerge from the Progressive Artists Group, and each extends from the 1940s into our present. In the work of Makbul Fida Hussain, altered cubist configurations enter into conversations with prior traditions of Indian sculpture and miniature paintings. Hussain sieved thereby the resources of epics and legends, gods and goddesses, to construe a distinctive modernist practice, coming up with novel idioms of space and time. Similarly, Newton Sousa, our man from Goa, fiercely guarded his autonomy in exile. Sousa's art conjures a formidable expressionism that is ever tied to figures and forms of a haunting past and a spectral present. This haunting past and spectral present signify space and create time. Here are to be found crucifixes and the Black Christ, Last Suppers and erotic nudes, the mother and the child. They each draw in the textures and tangles of a vernacular Christianity and an everyday ethic, exactly from the land where we sit now. At the same time, all this is done. At the same time, all this is done and undone, spatially and temporally, aesthetically and politically. All this is done and undone by the conjuring of a particular god. Quote, a god who is not a god of gentleness and love, but a god, rather, of suffering, vengeance, and terrible anger, unquote, as Edwin Mullins puts it. Consider now that literary modernisms in the mid-20th century engaged at once with related genres in the rest of the world, while seeking also to express a specific modern on the subcontinent. This could reveal formative tensions and critical creativity. As such, by the two most significant figures of Hindi modernism, Agay, Sachidanand Hiran Vatsayan Agay, and Gajanan Mata Muktibo. On the one hand, Agay stressed a formal universalism that concentrated on poetic structure rather than on social or historical problems. He emphasized thereby the immense isolation of the modern individual, a subject stalking an alienated temporality and a spatial indeterminacy. On the other hand, Muktibodh's intensely self-conscious, anguished poetic voice abandoned the high modernism of Europe and America for experimental, radical, sometimes surreal sequences. These sequences drew equally upon the Bhakti tradition of early modern India as upon other literatures of Asia, Africa, and Latin America, as Chaudhary has reminded us. They constructed new configurations of the mythic and the epic, space and time. Finally, mid-20th century cinema in the subcontinent straddled realist representations and innovative aesthetics that adroitly drew together the oral and the visual, sensibility and technique, dance and drama, the old and new, and the temporal and spatial. Thereby the cinema cast alienated individuals at the center, yet set them adrift. Think of Gurudev. It showed the finger to the promise of progress. It sealed the contradictions of imagined worlds. It held up a mirror to the lies of the nation, and it looked into the eye of a living ghost. It looked into the eye of a living ghost, India's partition and its intimate violence. Now the author and the actor, New Flaneur's both, could grimly move through the restless scuttle of quotidian creatures. Creatures scattered spatially, temporally, and everywhere one looked. The protagonists faced up, thereby, to the imminent possibility of an unclimatic end. Here was the cinema of Ritvik Bhatta and Satyajit Ray, but also of Gurudev and Khwaja Ahmad Abbas, among many others. This cinema recast mythology, rethought history, and reworked the contemporary in probing and unraveling the innocence and idea, the space and time of India. These mid-20th century modernists had arguably anticipated the unraveling of the South Asian nations from the 1960s onwards. Such unraveling has been acutely captured in recent decades by, for example, the wider narrative movement that emerged out of Baroda and the powerful articulation of Dalit literature and aesthetics. Leaving my exploration of these tendencies for the discussion ahead, at the close, I turn to a single modern subject. This subject's work and life not only articulate the two tendencies of the narrative movement and Dalit aesthetics indicated above, they also clarify some of my wider claims. So you might actually want to switch off the light. So I'm just going to let them run through as a, and you can ask me about the first few things. The subject in question is Savindra Savi Savarkar, an expressionist and Dalit artist of extraordinary imagination and prowess. His representations track the interplay between meaning and power within hierarchical regimes of religion, caste, gender, and politics, while drawing upon distinctive artistic and ideological influences. Elsewhere, I have explored three overlapping themes in Savi's work. First, the creation of a set of unsettling aesthetic political agendas in the realm of a critical and contemporary Dalit art. Second, the elaboration of such agendas through an entwinement of Ambedkarite ideology, existential attributes of being Dalit, and diverse representational resources, including varieties of expressionism, ranging across its early 20th century developments in Germany through to its 1960s manifestations in North America and Europe. And finally, the challenges posed to established procedures of art criticism by these distinct modalities of Dalit and expressionist artistic production. Here, I turn to what such considerations can suggest about Savi as a modernist creator, a modern subject, and a subject of modernity. But first, a brief introduction to our protagonist is in order. Savindra Savarkar was born in 1961 into a family of the Mahar caste in Nagpur. As part of Dr. Ambedkar's wider initiative, in 1956, his family converted to Buddhism. Savi first studied art at the University of Nagpur. Here, the constraining premises of an institution that continued to cherish the ideals of Victorian art and colonial aesthetics meant that it was in the ceaseless sketching of peoples and places, subjects and objects, that Savi honed his own artistic abilities. He spent long hours at the Nagpur railway station. These capacities were later developed through his other formal and informal studies and apprenticeships in a range of institutions and places. Indeed, Savi's paintings, graphics, and drawings the mind influences that range across expressionist art. The poet Tagore's critical drawings of the 1920s and 30s mentioned earlier, the narrative movement of the 1970s and 1980s, the delicate brushwork of Zen masters, and a wider disposition toward Buddhist aesthetics. Yet, far from being derivative, Savi's art conjoins acute apprehensions of an unjust, murky world with a vibrant use of color, conjuring figures and forms that are at once intense and haunting, forceful and haunted. The result is a radical expressionist imagination and a critical, Dalit iconography. Central to this iconography and imagination are specific representations of the past and the present, particular productions of time and space. The sources are overlapping and distinct, moving recitals of untouchable pasts by Savi's unlettered paternal grandmother, whom he describes as his first teacher. Liturgical lists drawn up within the political movement led by Dr. Ambedkar concerning the disempowerment faced by untouchables. And Savi's own experiences as an artist, an activist, and a Dalit in distinct arenas, from status spaces in New Delhi to remote places of gender and caste oppression in rural India. Unlike those tacit projections of the modernist artist fabricating forms through the creative force of a pure imagination, unlike all that, Savi seizes upon these discursive and experiential resources, seeding them while construing an expressionist art. Here, the past is not separated from the present. In order to temporally and spatially split prior caste hierarchies from contemporary intimations of equality. Rather, in Savi's art, the untouchable figures and upper caste forms, each inescapably gendered, are at once densely palpable and formidably spectral, stalking the past and the present, construing times and spaces of longing and loss that beget each other. Now the silence and sigh of the androgynous untouchables bursts forth into a stream. Quote, we were there then, we are here now. Now the gaze and grasp of the sexually predatory Brahman is unraveled through the terms of its own haunting. Far exceeding a mere documentation of history through images of oppression, Savi's art, quote, articulates the past and the present by seizing hold of a memory as it flashes up at a moment of danger, as Walter Benjamin would have wanted us to. Here, the unsettling realism of subterranean imaginings restlessly labors with the haunting terms of a forceful expressionism. The sun is eclipsed, the light is dark, the world in shadows, giving the lie to the phantasms of progress that haunt modern regimes of an exclusive temporality and its spatial segregations. Yet, the critical querying is accompanied by careful affirmation. For, in this mode of artistic production, the past and the present bring each other to crisis, compelling other intimations, remappings, as it were, of space and time, identity and nation, the word and the world. There's more to the picture. Behind these portrayals are particular modes of reasoning and a distinct order of subjectivity. You know, one of the problems with ethnographies and criticism of art is that they focus only on the visual, but there is a reasoning which goes into how the artist talks about her or his work. Behind these portrayals are particular modes of reasoning and a distinct order of subjectivity. These spell a rather specific modern subject. Careful critical conversations and meandering joyful exchanges with Savi, as well as a scam where I revised and rewrote his MA dissertation for submission to Academia San Carlos in Mexico City, have clarified that in speech and writing, Savi reasons by analogy. This analogical reasoning is imbued with a surplus of faith regarding Dr. Ambedkar's life and words, read and heard, a productive literalism concerning neo-Buddhist verities and veracities, rehearsed and performed. militating against logics and analyses of a straightforwardly analytical modern provenance, Savi's embodied expressionist reason sets the analogical and the literal to seize upon and sift through textual traces, oral liturgies, experiential entanglements, and graphic imaginaries. An offer is a visual hermeneutics that renders details with a twist. Here, haunting images resonate, but an oppression, but rooted in the force of the past. It is the force of the past that sums up repeating the fragmentary and the conception. All this is shored up by a vulnerable subjectivity. As a modern subject, Savi's presentation of the avant-garde, presentation of himself, as the avant-garde artistic self, consumed by cutting-edge creativity and unconstrained by conventional norms, has to yet bear an enormous burden. This is the unbearable weight of injuries of caste, hidden and obvious, which haunt his work and vocation. We are in the face of a self-fashioning subject whose despair and vulnerability, loss and longing, alongside his reasoning and literalism, expression and imagination, register that there are different ways of being modern. Ahead of us is a subject of modernity whose existence calls attention to the inflection of authority, to the inflection of alterity, of difference by authority, whose creativity points to the shaping of power by difference, and whose work attests to the presence of heterotemporal terrains and social spatial subjects as probing and producing each other. Thank you.
Thank you very much for an absolutely fascinating presentation, which was very, very wide-ranging, extremely thought-provoking in your readings of modernisms and the way in which you drew a very complex web of connections from the 19th century right up to the contemporary period. I will now open up the presentation for discussion. We need to have about 15 or 20 minutes. One of the audiences, yeah. Okay, bye. Thank you. So questions, comments, suggestions, that's would be better. Yes.
After this very erudite lecture, I am Dr. Savitri Sani, not a professional in your subject. I'm a doctor. I would like to know what is the influence in the Indian modern art of Satish Gujral from the Mexican painters like Diego Rivera, Rufino Tamayo, David Alfonso Cuarón. Is there really influence, or was it only in his early works and then later on he evolved into his own?
Thank you, Kukum. My questions will detract a little bit from the question that has been raised by the lady before me. So I will want you to answer it or respond to it at a different plane altogether, because it does not seek specific information. First of all, I think congratulations is in order. Kumkum has already done that for having looked the lion in the mouth. We have all been wondering all the while how exactly art forms relate to society. And as we all know, there is a wide variety of theories which can relate forms of social realism to forms of social structure, and social realism encompassing the variety of forms of modernist representation. My question based on this presumption is, and I'm saying this, as you know, I'm not an art historian or an art critic, but I am intrigued by the construction of your dyad, namely modern in its variety, and what you call the past, in the absence of which variety, I would like to know how the antonyms stand. Because the past, as we know, is not merely a chronological, spatial, and temporal entity. It is equally imbued with precisely those forms of artistic representation. We want to know how exactly this particular energy which you have captured with such eloquence would manifest if we were to give a name to this dyad or to the other end of the dyad, rather than the dull and prosaic past.
Professor Dube you referred to a gay and Gajanan Madhav Mukti Bodh. So I was wondering, how could you place them in the same template? Because generally, literary critics tell us that they have a different relationship with the past. A gay's relationship with the past is not the same. That's what we have been taught as that of Mukti Bodh. So I was trying to figure out that how do you look at different moments you traced, the construction of the popular, the construction of the national, etc., etc. Are they variations of the same theme or are they radically different?
Okay, so the first, thank you very much. It's a very important question. I think the influence of, your question is a very important one. The influence of the Mexican artists on Gujarat's work, I think it's not just about the specific images and representations that he carries away from, say, Rivera or... I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that Gujarat actually learned his mural techniques in Mexico. And there is something tangible, something material, something about the practice of muralism itself. So he might have gone, he might have returned to the theme, for example, a particular way of returning to the partition or whatever his later work. But the actual materiality, for the lack of a better term, of his practice of muralism is grounded in a certain experience. Right? So, that would be my very quick response. Majid, thank you very much for the question. Now, in a sense, what's really important here is that I am actually not setting up a dyad between the modern and the past, right? I am doing two things. I'm looking at the aggressive claims of the modern modernity, modernism, and modernization as a break, as a rupture with the past. But, I'm looking at them to think through them, but in a way where one recognizes that the aggressive claims exist. They are a part of the world. They're not just analytical nightmares which are going to disappear because, the scholar analyst, in this case me, doesn't like them. They exist. And yet, there's a certain conceit about these claims. There's a conceit about these claims which says it's about rupture. It's about, it's about a break. It's a surpassing of the medieval, of the traditional, etc., etc. It's a naming of something called tradition with a capital T, right? Now, my point is that traditions, as a set of specific kind of bodily orientations and mental orientations, do traditions in the plural might exist, but what is this conceit which names a singular tradition with a capital T, or a past which is always behind? So in other words, just very, very quickly, so that we have time for, what I am actually looking at, so you take the conceit seriously, because in order, in some senses, to think through it critically. And just put very, very quickly, the evilness that I was referring to, what I am interested in are heterotemporal spatial conflict formations, and I'm interested, in some sense, in heterospatial temporalities. In other words, I'm interested in the fact that the past is not just somewhere behind; it's very much a part of the present. We could take this further it's in this sense actually that that I approach. Let's say in this case, again, and in Mukti Bodh. I'm not saying by bringing them together as understanding them in terms of at one moment. I'm not saying that they are the same. I'm actually looking at the necessarily contentious relationship between them. I'm saying that like modernity. And the modernism is constitutively contradictory, right? Mukti Bodh and Agge represent different moments, different representations of the constitutive contradictions of modernism. In other words, I'm working through critical juxtapositions, unlike the tendency in literary criticism or art criticism, which brings together the similar. But why should we look at only the similar? you know, I think it's important to look at, to juxtapose the contraries, and which partly relates to your question as well. I mean, I'm very unhappy with diets, basically, but I also realize that oppositions and binaries, you know, they exist in the world. So it's about hanging on to both.
Okay, so on that note, I think we wind up. Thank you, Saurabh, for an excellent presentation and for an extremely stimulating discussion and the responses that came forward. Thank you so much.
And thank you so much.
It was a pleasure being here.
Thank you.
I think this scholarly exchange of connections through various sections deserves a huge round of applause. May I please request you to appreciate. Before we close, may I request our partners, Professor Raman and Professor Kamal, to kindly present a memento to both Professor Dube and Professor Roy. These are two different books on Goa, two different aspects, and I'm sure both of you will love to go through and read through it. As we close, may I request Professor Kamal to kindly propose a formal vote of thanks and close this session.
Friends, it is indeed a very special privilege and great joy for me to stand before you right now to extend a warm and hearty vote of thanks to all those who have made this function a success. As the president of the ICG had remarked in his opening speech, this session has been a confluence of three institutions: the ICG, the BITS Pilani Goa campus, and our Department of History, Goa University. On behalf of all these three institutions, at the very outset, I would like to place on record our most sincere appreciation and gratitude to the guest speaker of today, Professor Saurabh Dube, for his, what do I say, a very illuminating, thought-provoking speech, lecture on modernisms in India, which was delivered with such erudition, eloquence, passion, and enthusiasm that was so palpable. And also excited a lot of interest in the audience, and consequently we had a very animated interactive session. Thank you, sir, for being with us and for honoring us with such a stimulating lecture. I would also like to offer our most profuse thanks to the chairperson of today's function, Professor Kumkum Roy, for having accepted our invitation to chair the session and to share her ideas with us. It is with a deep sense of appreciation that I would like to acknowledge the contribution of our partner, BITS Pilani Goa Campus, represented over here by Professor Minakshi Raman, the head of the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at that campus. I would also like to thank a former colleague of mine who is now with the faculty of BITS Pilani, Dr. Pushkar, for putting us in touch with Dr. Dube and making this function possible. Thank you, Pushkar. A big thank you for the media for extending their generous coverage for this function. I would also like to place on record our deep sense of appreciation to the coordinator of the VRPP, that's the Visiting Research Professors Program at Goa University, Dr. Ram Rao Wah, for his support, logistic support, and guidance in organizing this function. As the president of the ICG remarked earlier, this is the 13th lecture of the Eminent Lecture Series organized by the ICG. 13 is supposed to be unlucky for some, but it has been spectacularly lucky for us at the Department of History, because on the 13th occasion of the lecture, we collaborated with them and it has really been a very meaningful collaboration this time around, and we look forward to many such collaborations with both the ICG as well as the Fitzwilliam Goa campus. And I would like to thank the driving force behind this function, the driving force of the host institution, the dynamic president of the ICG Goa, for providing us with this opportunity to collaborate in this particular manner. And a big thank you to the excellent support staff which is present at ICG, most ably led by their very dynamic and dynamic general manager, Mr. Arjun Halankar. A very big thank you to all of them from us. I also would like to extend my thanks to my colleagues and to the staff, and in particular to the students of our Department of History for extending the excellent cooperation in making this function a success. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, a most hearty vote of thanks to each and every one of you for having honored our invitation and graced the occasion, and for your active participation in the interactive session. Thank you once again.